In this figure, we're going to talk about protein regulation. And protein regulation is an enormously important topic because proteins are the gears in our metabolic machinery. These are the macromolecules that make our cells do the things they do. And so there are three main mechanisms through which protein regulation can occur. The first is an alteration of the microenvironment. Most proteins are found, we'll use our example down here on the left, in an aqueous environment, so surrounded by and interacting with free water molecules. Now, that water actually contains dissolved solutes, and the concentration and the allocation of those solutes within water determines this microenvironment. For instance, how much sodium is there? How much calcium is there? What's the concentration of free protons? What are the waste molecules found there? And many of those molecules or ions have the potential to interact with this protein. If you recall, proteins are stabilized in their three-dimensional shape by weak bonds that occur between adjacent amino acids within this structure. What happens is these solutes have the potential to disrupt these weak bonds when they're not in typical concentrations and alter the structure of that protein, alter the conformation. When that happens, we alter its function, possibly causing it to denature and become completely dysfunctional. Now, that can be adaptive in many cases. We can actually utilize changes in the microenvironment to adaptively regulate the protein. Hemoglobin acts that way. It responds to carbon dioxide levels that interact with that molecule to enhance its unloading of oxygen, adaptively maintaining the aerobic capacity of that tissue. And so that microenvironment changes could be detrimental, but in some cases, adaptively through evolution, these have become utilized mechanisms of regulating protein function. A second mechanism here is through altered expression. And that's alterations of the phenotype of these cells. In other words, what proteins of the DNA coding are expressed. A liver cell expresses some of the same proteins as a muscle cell, but not all. And the ones that are different are what make that liver cell a liver cell and the muscle cell a muscle cell, right? And so obviously during cellular differentiation, during growth, we have this essential alteration of expression. But it actually occurs all the time in mature cells in response to certain cellular stimuli. For example, some hormones will alter the expression of certain proteins to change cellular function over time, to make a tissue do something new that it wasn't doing previously. And we can usually undo that as well, remove the hormone and have that protein expression go back to normal. Now, in our last mechanism of regulation, that's altering structure. A really simple version of that is to take a precursor protein, cut a piece of it off, and end up with now an active protein. That's one example. But another really common example is phosphorylation. And phosphorylation occurs through a group of enzymes called kinases. It's a very large group of regulatory proteins that take a phosphate group from ATP and stick it onto an amino acid at a very particular location. And what that does is it alters the interactions between the side chains. You can see that now we're no longer interacting with this part of the chain over here on the right, right? It's drifted away a little bit. And so we've changed the shape of the protein, which of course changes its function. This gives us essentially an on-off switch, this phosphorylation, right? We can add the phosphate group through the kinase, activating the protein, giving the cell new function. We can also deactivate that protein through a phosphatase that does the exact opposite. It removes that phosphate group, returning the protein to its inactive state.